It's cool. We had a cool yesterday, too. It doesn't feel like August, but it is a good day to worship. It's a good day to come into this space and reflect on the goodness of God, and that's what we're here about. So, who's ready for that?
I am.
Thank you. I love your exuberance. Len, since you're ready, how about you lead us in our call to worship?
Join me in the call to worship. We walk in the wonder beneath the sun and stars. We give thanks for the air, the land, and the water. Beauty is before us, around us, over us, and beneath us. Please join us in hymn number 473. Our first reading today comes from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 2, verses 24 through 26. There is nothing better for mortals than to eat and drink and find enjoyment in their toil. This also, I saw, is from the hand of God. For apart from him, and who can eat or who can have enjoyment? For to the one who pleases him, God gives wisdom and knowledge and joy. But to the sinner, he gives the work of gathering and heaping, only to give to the one who pleases God. This also is vanity and chasing after wind. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, we come to our time of confession, where we reflect on our sins, our shortcomings, and we realize that they're not permanent. It's not an obstacle for God. God doesn't look at us and see the things that we have done and be like, ooh, gotta take a break from them. They just messed that up. Oh, no, that's not how it works. God is full of grace and forgiveness, and those things are freely given to us. And so we come to this moment to, humbly approach God and to confess our sins, trusting in the truth that God will forgive us over and over and over again. And so let's join our voices and join in our prayer of confession. Holy God, forgive our sins. Forgive the sins that we remember and the sins we have forgotten. Forgive our many failures in the face of temptation and those times when we have been stubborn in the face of correction. Forgive the times we have been proud of our own achievements and those when we have failed to boast in your works. Forgive the harsh judgments we have made of others and the leniency we have shown to ourselves. Forgive the lies we have told to others and the truths we have avoided. Forgive us the pain we have caused others and the indulgence we have shown ourselves. Lord God, have mercy on us and make us whole. Amen. Friends, God's love is sure and steadfast, and so receive the good news today that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. Let's stand and sing God's praise. Let me pray, and then we're going to jump in to the fun topic of today. But let's center our hearts, our souls, our minds, and be present here with God's Spirit. Holy God, we give you thanks for this moment, this time, where we can come, we can study your word, we can think about the ways in which you have called us to live and be in this world. And so we ask that you descend upon us in this space, that your Holy Spirit is present here, speaking into our hearts and our minds, that it is softening our hearts, it is opening our ears, it is helping us to see who you have called us to be and giving us the courage and the strength to walk in that way. Help us today to be more and more like Jesus Christ, our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. Now, today, we're dealing with the weighty subject of gluttony. Thank you. Now, if you are like me and you're like, oh, gluttony, I'm a little bit anxious about that. Like, is Joel going to stand up there and be like, hey, everyone, it's time to diet? No, I'm not going to do that. That's not what today's about. Our first text today, Len read from Ecclesiastes and says, hey, eat, drink, and be merry. What's wrong with having a little fun? What's wrong with enjoying life? Why should we not engage in some of these things and have some fun? And that's really the point of Ecclesiastes. There is this dual reality that the author is trying to get us to think about in which he is saying, hey, there's joy in the ordinary things of life. There is joy in all of the mundane that we do, and it's a gift from God. We should find joy in eating a good meal. When you sit down, like last night, I finally used the gift card y'all got me for Christmas like last year at a steakhouse last night with Amber. We went to the Hozier concert, and you don't have to know who that is, but we went, and Amber got a steak, and she was like, man, this is a good steak. And I said, I'm glad you enjoy it. You will never have one like that from me. I don't eat steaks. I don't know. But there's nothing wrong with enjoying that. There's nothing wrong with a nice glass of wine, a glass of whiskey, or the perfectly baked chocolate chip cookie. It's all good. And we should enjoy it. Because ultimately, we talked about this last week if you were here. It's a gift from God. God has given us these things in the world and says, this is for you. And so we shouldn't beat ourselves up. We shouldn't feel guilty about that. We should go, man, this is good. I mean, since when have you ever been given a gift in your life and been, you know, said, hey, here you go, don't have fun. Here's this cookie, but don't like it. I really hope none of you smile as you eat it. That would be ridiculous, right? But that's sometimes what we think. You know, how does this relate to gluttony? Well, most of our understanding of gluttony is kind of like sloth. We associate gluttony with overeating. Like, you talk about a gluttonous person, other than maybe being a glutton for punishment, but you talk about a gluttonous person as an overweight individual stuffing their face with stuff. And that's a bad thing. But that's not what's intended in this, in at least in kind of the way this is talked about. It's actually interesting. At least, I find it interesting. You might not find it interesting, but I'm a nerd. Gluttony, as one of the seven deadly sins, it doesn't seem as bad as pride or lust or greed, right? Like, you think of all of the sins we've talked about, and gluttony is kind of like, it's kind of weak sauce. It's like, oh, really? You don't want me to eat that thing. Like, don't get angry, don't be mean, but also don't have a second piece of cake. Like, of the two, which one are you really concerned with? Gluttony is kind of weird. It seems like a silly thing, you know, to call sin. It's kind of nitpicky. Like, really, that's what we're going to, you know, stand on our soapbox about is, like, you know, having too much food. But here's where it gets really interesting, for me at least. Historically, when you look at the lists that people made of the seven deadly sins and the way they talked about them, the way they organized the list, can you guess what was at the top of the list? Gluttony. When they started writing these lists in the 4th century, when this kind of idea of the seven deadly sins was established, gluttony was always at the top. It was always seen as the worst thing. So much so that when Thomas Aquinas comes about later and writes his list, he's a famous theologian, he spends quite a bit of time arguing why gluttony isn't at the top. Like, he felt it was so important to make the argument that he put greed and pride above gluttony. Like, think about that. To make that argument, to have to tell people for many pages why greed and pride are worse than gluttony, means that the thought of the time was gluttony is actually the worst thing you could do. Of all of the sin, gluttony is the worst. Isn't that fascinating? Now, hopefully you're scratching your head and being like, well, that seems silly. Like, was there just this trend of monks eating too much and they had to solve a problem? Like, what's going on? Well, really, it's probably rooted in the way that people talked about gluttony. You know, people like Gregory the Great, Augustine, Chrysostom, old dead white guys that, you know, dealt with theology. And the way they spoke of gluttony had little to do with eating, and had to do with kind of being this catch-all term for sins of the flesh. This idea that you would overindulge in the things of this world. Which makes more sense. Again, the seven deadly sins come from monastic communities. Communities that have cut themselves off from the world. And a lot of times ignore their earthly pleasures of the world. The desert fathers, rather than being the desert fathers, go into the wilderness to separate themselves. Some of you thought that was really funny, and some of you were like, Joel, just stop. But they separate themselves from the world. And so if they're going to separate themselves from the world, it makes perfect sense that the chief thing on their list would be like, don't overdo the things of the world. And that's what gluttony is. But when we think of our lives, when we think of our mission in this world, that might not work as well, that mindset, because, like, we don't live in monasteries. Like, that's just the reality. We are not desert fathers and mothers. Like, it's raining today, so, you know, we live differently. And the Bible as a whole is actually full of feasts and celebrations. Like, there is a lot of moments for us to engage in some fun and enjoyment, especially of food. I mean, the entire book of Esther is read during the Feast of Purim, which is a giant party. If you know anything about the Feast of Purim, like, it It's like the Jewish version of Mardi Gras. And they read Esther. It's really kind of fascinating. And that's a good thing. Jesus, over and over again in the scriptures, is found at table eating and drinking with people. He made wine. And his life was so focused on that, that one of the accusations against him is that he hung out with gluttons and debaucherous people. Like, when people saw Jesus and what he did, they're like, oh, you hang out with those people that eat and drink too much. And so, is that the way we should think about this? Is that necessarily a wrong thing? Is that, you know, kind of lifestyle and mindset of not finding enjoyment in the things of this world and some of those earthly pleasures bad? Well, to answer that, I'm going to invite us to think about what Jesus might say, because that's kind of what we do here, right? And if you want to follow along, you can open up your Bible to Luke 16, and we'll read our second scripture text of today, starting in verse 19. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, who feasted sumptuously every day. At his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick at his sores. The poor man died and was carried away in the angels by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was being tormented, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. And he calls out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger into cool water to cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus, in like manner, evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to there cannot do so, and no one can cross from here to us, or from there to us." And he said, "Then I beg you, Father, send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he can warn them, so that they will not also come into this place of torment." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them." He said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent." And he said to him, "If they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Last week, we talked about greed, which, again, Jesus has a lot of issues with. Jesus does not speak highly of the rich. And though he doesn't speak in these terms, I think Jesus would see gluttony as an extension of greed. If greed is the constant desire, the never-ending feeling of wanting more, gluttony is the consistent consumption of it, and especially the consumption of things at the expense of another. Whereas Marie Antoinette, you know, famously declared, "Let them eat cake," Mary, the mother of Jesus, in regard to his coming, said, "Fill the hungry and send the rich away empty." And here in this moment, in this parable that Jesus is telling, he tells this parable in three parts. The first part, he tells us about the characters, and he makes some pretty clear contrasts for us that should catch our attention. There's a rich man. He's a well-dressed rich man. He's got purple robes, which is super expensive. He's got fine linen. He's feasting sumptuously every day. He has had it all. He has lived it up. He you know, can do whatever he wants. And there's this poor man, in contrast, who lived at the gate. He's not covered in clothes, but he's covered in sores. Instead of feasting, he's feasted upon as the dogs continually lick at his sores. And he longs for scraps from the table of the rich man, which the text never say come. So you have a rich man who has everything that he needs and some, and chooses not to care for those around him, and a poor man who longs for anything and has nothing. Act 1. Then you turn to Act 2 in this text, and kind of the theme of Ecclesiastes, we're told everyone dies. Sorry. That's just the end. But there is a surprise twist. The rich man, who has seemingly experienced God's grace and God's blessing, ends up in Hades, while the poor man, Lazarus, is sitting at the side of Abraham. Their assumed fortunes are completely reversed. If you turned this into a movie, you might cast Dan Aykroyd, Eddie Murphy, call it Trading Places, something like that. I don't know. And the question that Jesus is kind of getting at, and what he invites us to consider, is why is this reversal? What happened? Why is the rich man, who you think is really good and done really good things in a place that's not really fun and wonderful, and the poor man who you would look at and go, oh, well, you know, do better for yourself, is actually in the presence of Abraham? And Abraham tells us the answer in the parable. Abraham says, child, remember that during your lifetime you received good things, and Lazarus in like manner received evil things. And now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. And besides all of this, between you and us is a great chasm, and it has been fixed so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us. The rich man sees what has happened and sees how the circumstances have switched and says, wait a second. This is not how things are supposed to work out. This is not right. And the message Jesus teaches through Abraham is, hey, there's a chasm there between you. There was a moment where when you lived, that chasm existed and you didn't try to fix it. And now that you are dead, that chasm is fixed. In life, you had a chance to do something different, and instead you just kept eating and consuming all that you had and all that you were given instead of helping those around you. And now that you are gone from life, that's the fixed reality. In the words of Martin Luther King Jr., who wrote a sermon on this text, he said, "The rich man is the white man who refuses to cross the gulf of segregation and lift his Negro brother to the position of first-class citizenship because he thinks segregation is part of the fixed structure of the universe. The rich man is the American capitalist who never seeks to bridge the economic gulf between himself and the laborer because he feels that it is unnatural for some to live in inordinate luxury while others live in abject poverty. The sin of the rich man was not that he was cruel to Lazarus, but that he refused to bridge the gap of misfortune that existed between them. His sin was not his wealth. His wealth was his opportunity. His sin was the refusal to use his wealth to bridge the gulf between the extremes of superfluous, inordinate wealth and abject, deadening poverty." In other words, his sin is gluttony. He had all these things. He had all of these things in his life. And instead of using what he had for the blessings of others, he just consumed it. It's mine. It's my food. It's my table. It's my feast. I can do what I want. I'll eat it all. And sorry, there's no cookies left for you. And then you get to the third act of this parable. And the third act of the parable is the hard word for those that were listening and us. It's the crux of the parable. It's the challenge for all of us to actually listen to the first half of it. You know, the rich man is seeing what has happened. He is seeing that he has lost the opportunity to bridge the gap in life. And he says, I don't want this to happen to my brothers. So, Abraham, can you help me out? Can you go tell my family to do things differently? to go share God's blessings with the world around them, the poor and the outcast, the people that sit at their gate longing for something. Can you go and help them? Everyone the world says is unclean, just tell them to care for them. And Abraham says, that's what Moses and the prophets say. And if you're not going to listen to that, they're not going to be convinced. Even if someone rises from the dead. Just a nice little foreshadowing of what happens. But he's making this point. You know, what Jesus is inviting people to see and understand, and us to see and understand, is that this isn't new. Jesus isn't preaching something or teaching something that's like brand new to the people. This isn't a new economic or ethical standard where he's like, let me change the world as you know it. He is giving them the reality that has been proclaimed from the very beginning. This idea of having what we have for the benefit of others rather than just consuming it all for ourselves. That's not new. Abraham, the very first thing he is told when God calls him and says, hey, you have been blessed to be a blessing. As the people of God, you have been blessed to be a blessing. To the law and the prophets state over and over and over again that idea. And Jesus and Abraham in this moment are making the point that if you're not willing to hear that now, well, when Jesus rises from the dead, you're still not going to listen. If you can't hear that now and see that invitation and do something now, there's nothing that's going to change your mind. And I think that's the harsh word for us today. It's the challenging word for us. You know, we have the benefit of sitting on this side of kind of Christ's death and resurrection. Like, we know how the story ends, and so we're like, oh, that's good. And yet, we still hoard and consume what we consider is ours. We still search for arguments not to help people. God helps those who help themselves, right? No, that's not in the Bible. That's Ben Franklin. Give a man a fish and you'll feed him for a day. Teach him to fish. You'll feed him for a lifetime. I did some fishing this weekend. It was wonderful. Emerson caught a largemouth bass. It was great. But that's also not in the Bible. Instead, in the Gospel of Luke, you get Jesus saying, hey, blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, because you're going to get filled. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, because you're going to get hungry. You also get, hey, love your enemies. Do good and lend, expecting nothing in return. Bridge the chasm between people. If you can do that, your reward will be great and you will be a children of the Most High, for God Himself is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful just as your Father is merciful. That's a challenging bar. Those are those teachings of Jesus that you're like, ooh, I don't know if I can do that. That's difficult. And the problem is that is Christ's kingdom ethic. That is how the kingdom of God is supposed to work. And it is really hard. It is really challenging. It's hard for me. It's probably hard for you. It's not easy. And I think that's the crux of gluttony. It's not about eating too many cookies. Like, you probably shouldn't do that either. It's not healthy. But also, that's not the point. It's this reality that too often God blesses us to be a blessing in this world, and instead we just line our pockets and we get our fill. And the chasms between us and others just continue to grow. And yet we sit here today in Act 1 of the parable, which is interesting to think about, because none of us have died. None of us are at that point We sit in the moment where we can choose to be different. We have the chance still to build bridges. And I think that's good news. That's the good news for us. That was the good news for the hearers of this parable, that they could do something different. Yeah, we are totally allowed to eat, drink, and be merry. That is okay. It is biblical. It is good to see the ordinary things in life as a gift from God. But also, we're called to find ways to bring others into that enjoyment. We're called to find ways to shrink the chasm between us and them. The story of our faith starts by saying you have been blessed so that you can be a blessing. And that is our call today and every day, to see ways that we can use our gifts that God has given us for the benefit of others in this world. Let's pray. Holy God, we give you all thanks and praise. We ask that you open our eyes to see the ways in which you have blessed us, the ways in which we have a great deal of gifts and talents and offerings in our lives. We give you thanks for these things. We give you thanks for the things that we don't always recognize, and just ask that you are opening our eyes and our spirits to them. But also give us the convictions to bless others, to see what we have as a gift from you for the betterment of those around us, that we can shrink the chasms between us, that we can bridge the divides that so often exist in our world, and we can help others experience your grace and your mercy and your love. We give you thanks for inviting us into this, to see this, to enact this in the world today. And we pray this all in the wonderful and the beautiful name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's stand and sing. Amen. You may be seated. I read that hymn a week ago, and I was like, this is perfect for gluttony. I don't know. That's moments I have. A couple things for us in the life of our church. First, our way of the week is to tell your story. Part of the way we bless others is by sharing the reality of our lives and our experience and the stories we have. As you know, I'm a pretty big proponent of storytelling. I think it's a really good thing. That's why I like parables. It's all the things. And your stories are important. We talked about this on Tuesday, but you know, and I've said it before, imagination is an amazing tool. Imagination, when you engage in it, actually makes your body and all of your chemicals and all of the things respond as if you were experiencing it. It's a great way to bring about empathy and change is by telling stories. And you've got a story to tell. So Tell your story, whether that's here or outside in this world. Share something about yourself. Be vulnerable, but help others experience the ways, as Marty kind of pointed out, that God speaks into your life and has changed you and transformed you. Now some stuff happening, going on. Tuesday we have our Bible study. We're still looking at the book of Colossians, so come join us. Colossians is only 4 chapters, so you can read it over and over and over again, or you could not read it at all and just show up. That's fine too. Just join us. Next Sunday we have a meet and mingle after worship, so be prepared for that, to stay a little bit extra, to chat some more, to share some stories, to eat some food, all those good things. We also have a choir breakfast coming up for people who are interested in kind of getting more information, learning about that. There's information in the bulletin, but also if you don't want to sing and you just want to hang out, you can come too. It's for everyone, but it's kind of like a, it's potluck, but what are those, like when someone sells you a timeshare, like come and get some food, but also there's going to be a sales pitch on why you too can join the choir. So maybe that doesn't actually help. I don't know. I always go to them, so I like good food. Mark your calendar for that, as well as when the choir practices are, which are in your bulletin as well. And again, I said this a couple weeks ago, but we're looking at some Wednesday plans. I'm thinking of doing some more teaching, lecturing, or just kind of engaging topics that people are interested in and want to learn about or think about outside of the context of worship or something like that. So if there's something that you would love to engage, please reach out, let me know, and we can see whether that's getting someone else to come in and talk about it or me or whatever it is. We'd love to work towards that. And I believe that's all that's happening in the next week, unless a hand shoots up and says no. You got it? All right. And now we'll just continue in worship, giving of our tithes and offerings, and giving back to God what God has blessed us with. Holy God, we just ask that you help us cultivate a mindset of gratitude, that in our giving we take a moment to recognize the goodness, the grace, and the mercy of God that we have received, the ways in which you have blessed us. And we ask that you take this offering and that you use it so that through our blessings we might continue to bless others, that the world might come to know the goodness of God. And we pray this all in the wonderful and the beautiful name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, let's join in singing the great hymn of the church, How Great Thou Art. Next week, we finish up our little journey through the seven deadly sins. After that, we're going to do a little journey through the book of Ephesians, which is a great book. I don't think I've ever preached on Ephesians here, and I love it, and I love all of them, so I don't know why I say that all the time. But so you can mark your calendars for that. And then in the month of October, we're going to do a sermon series that I am kind of excited about, because if you don't know, we have an election happening in like November, I guess. But I'm preaching a sermon series entitled right now, "It's the End of the World as We Know It." And I feel fine. But it's going to be kind of looking at promises of God and the kingdom of God and things like that. But I thought that would be fun. Also, speaking of the end of the world as we know it, I'm going to do a series on Tuesdays about the book of Revelation in the coming weeks. So if you're interested in that, probably start in about a month. So you can mark your calendars for that. One of the reasons I chose that last hymn is we know it and we love it and it's wonderful and we can all sing it with gusto without the words and it's great, but it begins by kind of acknowledging the greatness of creation, the goodness of the world around us. And as we talked about gluttony today, and I kind of focused on the reality that there are so many ways that we are blessed and we don't try to bless others. One of the other sides of that, and I think the hymn reminds us of that, is that we're blessed as we look at this world around us. And yet, we should also talk about the ways in which we destroy the world around us at the expense of future generations and things like that. Like, that too is an aspect of this. It is not just our finances or the physical things we experience or the tables that we have that are full of bounteous and sumptuous things. It's also about the reality that like the blessings of God are not limited to what's in our wallet or bank account. The blessings of God are all around us and everywhere. And we should be mindful of that. We should be mindful of the ways in which we are, you know, hurting the things that God has given us for the benefit of others. And I think that hymn in particular stirs a sense of awe and gratitude and wonder in the goodness of God's creation as well. So just food for thought as you continue on in your day and in your week. But as you go, may the Lord God be with you. And may God bless you with the gift of tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, and starvation, the loss of all that they cherish, so that you may reach out your hand and comfort them and transform their pain into joy. And may God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you really can make a difference in this world, so that you are able to do with God's grace what others claim cannot be done. Go today just grounded in the love and the joy and the peace of God. Amen.